It's a real challenge to create global scale, real-time collaborative applications. Each piece of architecture you add increases latency. Chris Anderson is here to show us how we can easily solve this challenge using Azure Cosmos DB, Azure Functions, and SignalR today on Azure Friday. Hey everyone, Donovan Brown here with another episode of Azure Friday. I'm here with Chris Anderson. Chris, how did you solve this challenge?
Yeah, so I mean, we had this interesting challenge where we wanted to build a real-time collaborative dashboard or canvas that lets you go through there and then draw with other people in real time. And we wanted to kind of see whether or not we could use Cosmos DB to solve this problem.
All right, cool. So what is this app here? This is just a demo app, right?
Exactly. So the idea here is I want to be able to go ahead and draw on this t-shirt here that we've got, Scott's lovely red t-shirt.
Exactly.
And then I want to go ahead and be able to see it show up in near real time on my other screen. So you can see here, as I'm drawing, these updates are showing up on my other screen. We can even go and throw some extra colors inside of here. And what's cool is I can do this on either one of these. I can also go through here and draw on this one straight across, and we'll see this show up like that. And so, you know, these are two different screens. It's going up there and it's got to go to the cloud and come back down again. How are we able to get this to happen quick?
Great. How many people could be drawing at the same time?
You know, we designed this thing for build. So we designed it for, I think we planned for build 2x, so like 20,000 people or something.
Wow.
I think we quoted like 20,000 people as our original specs.
Awesome.
And we wanted to do it without any provisioned VMs, basically. So we were trying to go for like the managed services kind of approach.
Gotcha. So this is very PaaS. Like you're talking about functions.
There's a serverless thing in there.
Perfect. Yeah. So show me how was this actually architected then?
Yeah. So in terms of architecture, we wanted to. It's also kind of simple in a lot of ways. We've got the client, of course, which is just kind of the browser that you're seeing there. The client is talking to the API for doing login and for doing inserts.
Okay.
That insert is using the user's identity to also throttle. The people who are using it via Twitter. When you logged in through Twitter, we didn't know who you were.
Gotcha.
What things you wanted to do, so we wanted to throttle you down. And so we're able to do that by using app services identity or identity and authorization service to actually go through and figure out, okay, they're from Twitter, they're from AAD, who are they?
Gotcha.
And then we were able to track that using Cosmos DB.
Oh, very cool.
And then it's syncing all that data down into Cosmos DB. And then we're actually having a SignalR app go through there and pull all that from the Cosmos DB change feed, which allows you to see all the different updates that happened to that Cosmos DB. And then it's piping those directly to the client. That's how you get the real-time effect.
I see. So instead of me having to go and run a query against Cosmos saying, okay, show me everything so that I can figure out where I was, you're just getting this feed of constant updates saying, this is where we are, this is what you need to know about, and offloading that. The querying part, that's no longer my concern.
Exactly.
Got it.
And
okay.
If you had to write that query, it could take a long time. We're having to go through there and search in every document for the right one. With this model, it's literally just an ordered log of things that changed.
All right, perfect. Yeah, because I mean, the more data you get, the longer that query takes to execute, everyone starts to slow down. But because we're getting this change feed, everyone stays, like you said, near real time.
Exactly.
Got it. Okay.
And then the other challenge that you might have if you're building an application like this with in terms of collaborative drawing is you need to basically kind of sync to a source of truth. You don't want someone to have to go through there and replay the whole log every time they connect to their client. And so we have this other function here, which is basically creating a snapshot for us of events.
Okay.
So every time that you were to add a pixel, it's not only being streamed to everyone else immediately, but it's also being saved into a blob, which represents the current state of the board.
Okay.
And that allows us to, you know, load the client very quickly without having to go through there and then replay the whole history and see the thing animate with every single drawing.
Gotcha.
But the cool thing with this is since Cosmos DB is storing every single insert, I'm actually able to replay the whole thing and see how it was drawn pixel by pixel.
Interesting. But the snapshot allows me to join the conversation late and then pick up right where everyone else is because I get that snapshot and it's fast because I'm not replaying it. I'm like, dude, this is where they are. Join the fun and start drawing, and then everyone starts to see my real-time drawing.
Exactly.
Well. Got it. Okay, so whenever people say Cosmos DB, it's like this magical black box, right? But Cosmos has several different like functions or ways to interact with it. What portions of Cosmos DB did we use that made it Cosmos the answer, not just like a random SQL server or something like that?
Yeah, so in this case, the key pieces I wanted was I wanted to be able to store documents because I could have modeled it in a couple different ways, but I was storing batches of pixels in a lot of cases. When I was doing the kind of sketch model that we were allowed to do for the people who were presenting on stages and whatnot, we wanted you to be able to insert large batches of those things. And that was really better representative as like one document that represented that batch kind of line than as like a bunch of individual records in a table.
Gotcha.
So I would have had to like have like stroke ID or something like that to be able to track them together. documents really just made sense for the kind of data we were trying to store.
I see.
The other thing that I needed to have was I needed to have real-time updates. And interestingly enough, like this is actually not an original idea. This is an idea that we were able to kind of learn from the people who built Reddit Place. So they have this awesome blog post where they went through kind of all the trial and error. It saved me a lot of initial issues. And one of the cool things here is you can kind of see what their end architecture looks like. And you can see it looks very similar in a lot of ways. They're using Cassandra in place of where we use Cosmos, they're using Cassandra. They're actually using Redis, and we're also using Cosmos for that because Cosmos has the same latency as Redis.
Oh,
and
great.
So we didn't end up having to go ahead and use some kind of lower latency database. We were able to continue to use Redis for that. And then they're using WebSocket service, we're using SignalR. And they probably had like a bunch of servers they had. We just used functions because that way it automatically scaled up to what we needed to
Perfect.
Do.
And so what we're able to do is simplify this architecture because where they had to use multiple services, we were able to get all that power right from Cosmos DB.
Exactly.
Got it. Okay, perfect, perfect. Very cool.
And so yeah, so from there we can kind of talk about like each of these individual pieces.
Okay.
And so the quick one is to go ahead and look to see how do we insert those records from the client, right?
Perfect.
How what did that function look like? So yeah, let's take a look at the API and see how we're actually inserting the pixels.
Okay.
So from here, you can see that we've actually got update pixel. This is just a function written inside of the C# functions project type that Azure Functions has now. It generates the function.json for us, so we don't have to worry about it.
Oh, cool.
Inside of this, it's an HTTP triggered function. You can see that we've got the attribute here. And we're not actually doing anything else inside of this. No other bindings. One of the things I'm using here is I'm actually using the Cosmos client directly because I wanted to change some configuration on it that wouldn't otherwise be exposed through the binding.
Okay.
So one interesting thing here that I'm going through there and I'm just ensuring that we've actually got the cores rules applied. And in order to do the kinds of interesting things I wanted to do with cores and passing credentials back and forth, you actually have to turn off the cores rules that service has out of the box because they're simple mm-hmm. and you have to kind of take over cores fully. So I've just got this nice helper method here which goes through there and fixes up my core settings for the requests.
Okay.
From there, I'm actually going through there and checking to see whether the user is authenticated or not.
Right.
I'm using App Services authentication authorization feature that they've got, which will basically prompt people for logging in with Twitter if they go to the site and they're not authenticated yet. And, well, if they click on the login button, if you can visit the site unauthenticated, but if you want to insert pixels, I prompt you, hey, you should log in. And then it redirects you to the login, and then it comes back.
Got it. Okay.
With that, I'm just going through here and I'm reading some headers. That's allowing me to go ahead and get the ID and basically what the identity provider is. I have a kind of a difference between how I handle AED logins, which is what I'm using for the demo presenters. They're logging with AED credentials. And then for Twitter users, they can log in and then I'd see that the identity provider is Twitter here.
Got it.
From here, I'm actually going through and reading in all of my pixels. Like I said, I had this interesting challenge that the Reddit Place folks didn't have, where I wanted to actually handle canvas brush strokes as well as individual pixel updates.
Okay.
And so that means I had to handle basically an array of pixels being uploaded to me from basically a single batch stroke.
Got it.
So I'm just going through there and unpacking this. You can see if there's a problem, I just send back a bad request message.
Okay.
And then from there, I'm then going through there and then doing user throttling. So I've got stuff where I can actually block users. If you were trying to make little bad pictures inside of there, I was able to add you to a naughty list and,
nice.
And you got removed. If you are an admin, which is right now just set to if you're using AD, you are an admin. So anyone from Microsoft was just
free having to draw
fun.
Whatever they wanted to draw.
Exactly. I set that. And then if they're not an admin, then I go through there and I check to see whether or not they can actually do the insert. So I go ahead and grab their last insert time, and then I update the user if they're still allowed to go. So basically, I update the user before I actually commit the pixel. That way, there's not any weird trick where somehow they are able to insert by breaking my user permission logic.
Got it. So now we know who they are, and we know if they should or should not be throttled. And this information is all being pumped right now into Cosmos DB.
Exactly.
All right. And then are you going to show us really quickly how the viewers or the people who are watching it get draw, where we're reading the, what did you call it, the real-time feed of data, the change log, or?
Yeah. So now after I insert those things, basically I've got this pixel service, which is acting as my singleton, which is managing the Cosmos connection for me.
Okay.
You can use singletons inside of Azure Functions to make sure you have a single client. And that prevents you from like opening lots of different requests and having socket exhaustion and things along those lines.
Sure, you don't want to leak your
And it also increases the speed. If you create a new client for each time, it's going to slow it down. So in this case, I've got a hot, warm client that I can use for most requests.
Okay.
And then I insert that batch, then it comes back, and we should hopefully be fine. We should never hit this 500 error, hopefully. And then the interesting thing here is at the end, once again, I have to fix up the cores rules once again. So as soon as you have to take some manual control over the cores rules, we know that that can get complicated. And with functions, because there's no like middleware plugins you can use to take care of this for you, you end up having to kind of write some of it yourself.
Got it.
But that's a whole other episode. So in terms of how we then read those updates, we've actually got two different projects. So if you remember from this screen here, we've got the SignalR project, which is sending the updates to the client directly.
Right.
And then you've actually got the update processor function, which is then storing them to a blob.
Right. And are they both reading the same change feed?
Exactly.
Yeah. Okay. So
exact same change feed. The interesting difference between the two of them is the function app is actually using the change feed trigger we have inside of Azure Functions.
Okay.
So you don't have to write a line of code related to Cosmos. You can get these updates using Azure Functions change feed trigger.
Okay, cool.
If you're using SignalR, you have to use the change feed library. And that involves a little bit more specific logic about understanding how Cosmos is going to work and how its libraries work.
Plugged together.
But Functions is going to obviously try to go the extra mile to abstract you away from what services you're talking to.
Okay.
So we can start with the SignalR project since that one's interesting. So you can see here we've got the change feed reader. And this is the one that is actually going through there and pulling our change feed by using our document client.
Is the SignalR app that we're talking about right here.
Exactly.
Okay,
yeah.
Got it.
So you can see we've got the document client. I'm actually passing in my iHub context. So my SignalR hub context is getting passed in as well.
Okay.
As part of the constructor for creating my change feed reader. There's a library that we have called change feed processor, which is actually a library which helps you go through there and like scale out to many machines to do this. And that one's used if you want to process a single message once. But SignalR is kind of interesting. In the case of SignalR, we're actually trying to, for all clients, send all events that possibly happened, right? That's at least for the design we chose here. We could have had different like rooms and stuff like that.
Sure.
In this case, we wanted all events from Cosmos to be going through all clients of SignalR.
Okay.
And so in this case, we actually had the opposite problem, where instead of wanting an event to be processed once, we wanted an event to be processed by all clients.
Got it.
And so that's why we wrote this thing which kind of inverses the process, where we're effectively reading from the change feed from all partitions and then sending it out over all listeners for this particular SignalR hub.
Perfect.
And so you can see here, we're kind of initializing that, and then we've just got this, like, it's a fairly long, like, while this is running, we're going to go through there, and we're going to create our document change feed query. This is basically going to go and grab all documents that we had, and the main things that we're passing on this options object are a max item count, and we're passing in something which is keeping track of our, kind of our cursor. So you can kind of imagine where we are in the change feed. We want to keep track of that as we're going along to make sure that we don't repeat ourselves.
Sure.
So we go down here, and then the kind of fun piece ends up being where we then submit this to SignalR. So what we'll end up doing is we find that there's actually changes that we do want to send across. We can then go ahead and just do clients all send changes, and then we're just serializing the objects and passing it back in the response.
Got it. And then this is where everyone listening gets a notification and then draws the pixels on their screen as well, so everyone catches up.
Got it. And this is another interesting case where we had to kind of play with different batch sizes. When we're sending results to Cosmos DB, we were sending a batch for basically each stroke or each single upsert. But in this case, you're going to be having lots of different updates happening all at once from lots of different clients, or you could be having multiple people trying to do strokes at once.
Sure.
So we kind of have lots of different updates trying to go to a couple of different clients.
Okay.
And SignalR is kind of optimized for a certain size of message.
Okay.
And so we do a lot of the work that you kind of see here is us kind of optimizing for what is the size of each of those payloads that we then send across the wire to make sure that we're keeping the pipe optimal, but also full.
Sure.
And trying to not have too much latency that happens once things start to get really busy.
Got it.
And so you do have to do some massaging of data. You can't just send large messages across and expect that they're going to happen at low latency.
Got it.
You want to make sure that you still keep things to kind of the optimal size for SignalR.
Perfect.
But yeah, that's pretty much all that happens. This just sits there and runs on a web app that we have running. And it listens for events and then sends them to clients, and it kind of just works.
That's very cool. And then the other one was where we actually process them to go into the snapshot.
Yeah, so the trick here is that we wanted to have the stored snapshot of stored into blob storage, and when we're running on pxdraw.azure.com, like the production one that's deployed into multiple regions all around the world, we wanted that to be stored in a CDN, so that way if we were getting hit by 20,000 requests a second, that it didn't kill our blob storage account. That wouldn't be ideal, right?
Absolutely, yeah. And a CDN's that's literally what it's for.
Exactly.
Right. So being able to utilize that to cache the snapshot so that everyone can join in and it feel like it's, like I said, near real time.
Yeah. And so we used Azure CDN. We were able to set the refresh setting to 30 seconds. So every 30 seconds, it'll go through there and refresh its cache of the blob.
Got it.
And that means that blob is at most 30 seconds behind what the state of the world is.
Gotcha.
So if someone's coming in there, you know, there might be a little bit of a jump. You could always reduce that latency down to like 5 seconds or something like that. It's really up to you.
Sure.
But then the change feed processor ends up being relatively simple for what you have to do, because it's just a matter of reading from that change feed, which we get a lot of that code for free from functions.
Right.
And then we just have to figure out how to pack it back into the blob and then update the blob.
Perfect.
And so for that, we actually have this update processor. And you can see here we've got this functions. And this one is going to go through there. Well, the interesting case here is when you're using the Cosmos DB trigger, what you want to do is you want to use an I read-only list for the document. If you go ahead and just use document doc, you're going to get a single document at a time.
Oh, wow.
And once again, batching ends up helping you a lot with throughput. There's overhead for each individual execution. If you can process a batch, you're going to get a lot more throughput.
Perfect.
So from here, we go through there and make sure that the docs wasn't zero for some particular reason. And then we go ahead and unload all those things. And then we have this kind of pixel class that we wrote that could go ahead and take all those pixels, kind of unpack all their different kind of X, Y coordinates and what the color was. Mm-hmm. And then it actually repacks it into a binary format.
Okay.
And so that binary format is basically we have a giant kind of fixed length binary string where each pixel is represented by 4 bits.
Okay.
That allows you to choose from 15 different colors.
Gotcha. It's
and so that's like how we're able to have all the different colors there.
Yeah, it's like almost like your own little bitmap format that you created.
That's exactly what it is.
Got it.
And that allows us to basically send something, which is also condensed over the wire.
Sure, absolutely.
We didn't want to send, this is a million pixels. It's 1,000 by 1,000 pixels. We didn't want to send a million, it'll be like 3 million properties instead of a JSON. That's
exactly, yeah. Be crazy. No one wants to see that. Awesome.
And so this ends up being a relatively small document, which means that it loads fast when you refresh the client. We can go ahead and just demo that here live. When you refresh this, it refreshes really quickly because it's actually loading a very small document. And then it's just a matter of how quickly can the JavaScript render that binary object into the canvas. And that's most of the latency that you saw there.
Gotcha.
Especially since it can cache.
Yeah, exactly. This is incredible. Being able to take the architecture that you saw earlier and then reduce it down to the features that we have inside of Azure just makes your life a lot easier. And being able to take several of them and combine them all into Cosmos DB so that you have, again, just that one less thing you have to deal with, that one less hop over the wire, allowing you to get the performance that you want. This is really, really cool stuff.
And for all these pieces, it took us a week to build this. We had a front-end engineer. We had someone work on just a SignalR piece because he really wanted to play with this new SignalR piece that came out. And then I managed to do all the functions pieces, and we all kind of came together. The client ended up being some of the hardest pieces because you have to get the JavaScript canvas to kind of update properly and things along those lines. We played some interesting games where we would actually cache the events that we got from the WebSocket. So when you got a blob update come in, we actually would look at the LSN on the blob and then only replay events from that LSN. So you never saw any double replays on the client.
Cool.
And that took some like hard learning. But that was specific towards our client section.
Side, exactly.
Getting the actual notifications ended up being the easiest part. It was all tweaking in the client for our kind of final
run. Right. The parts that Azure provided were the snap. That was the easy part. It was the stuff you had to do on top of that that was tricky.
If we did a video on the client code, it'd be 3 or 4 videos.
I believe it. Well, thanks so much for coming and showing this. We're learning all about creating near real-time applications using Azure here on Azure Friday.